Let me start by recapitulating very quickly what we saw at the end of the last lecture, or the second lecture. So we saw basically a uniqueness result for the regular flow, which says the following, that if the continuity equation with the velocity b has a uniqueness of solutions, remember that we always speak about uniqueness in a given function space. For my lectures, the function space will be L infinity with values in L1 intersection L infinity, or to be more precise, I need only uniqueness in the class of non-negative functions. Then if we have uniqueness in this class, then there is at most one regular flow. And maybe behind this result, there is another result which I used to prove this statement, which is even more important, which tells us this, that if you have a probability measure, remember, on Rd cross gamma t, let's say concentrated on ODE solutions, and with the property, of course, of regularity, which means that the trajectories do not concentrate, so the marginals of this kind of process have bounded density with respect to Lebesgue measure. And again, if CB has uniqueness, then in some sense we can say that there is no branching of trajectories, at least the trajectory is selected by this probability eta. So we can say that eta has a graph structure. So there is, remember, the disintegrations of eta were Dirac masses, and the points where these Dirac masses were concentrated give rise to individual trajectories, mu bar, where of course mu bar is the zero diesis of eta. Okay, now I'm going to use precisely this kind of statement to get existence of the flow and also some form of stability that we will discuss later on. Okay, let me go to existence. So let's say existence of the flow. Well, it is sufficient to combine this result. So as soon as you are able to build some meta, then you have a flow, right? How can I build eta concentrated on the solutions satisfying this with this property? So first of all, so as I said, it is sufficient to build eta. First of all. Second, well, we know that in order to have an eta, it is sufficient by the superposition principle to build a solution to build, let's say, non-trivial solutions to the continuity equation. Let's say non-trivial, non-negative solutions with bounded density. Okay, as soon as you are able to build non-trivial solutions, then you can represent them by superposition principle, and then you have eta. Okay, now this is simple. I mean, for instance, under the growth condition, under the usual growth condition, I already introduced an infinity. Under this growth condition, plus a quantitative condition on the divergence, that the negative part belongs to L1, L-infinity. Under these two conditions, for instance, you can modify your vector field. The epsilon. And it is easy to see that these bounds are retained under modification, right? And so you are able this way to build solutions uniformly bounded because of this condition, right? These a priori estimates which comes from the Cauchy-Lipschitz theory. And you have no problem in passing to the limit here because B epsilon are strongly convergent up to subsequences. Mu epsilon are weakly convergent to some mu t, and then you have built your solution. Okay. So in general, of course, this approximation procedure always works and always gives you a kind of multivalued flow, which is eta. But if you add to your assumptions this ingredient, that the continuity equation has uniqueness, you know that any multivalued flow has no branching, and then you recover a flow. Okay? So let's say that under these two conditions, together with this condition which prevents, roughly speaking, branching, we have existence and uniqueness of the flow. Okay, so now I start to discuss maybe I will discuss the stability question later on, although the ideas are very much similar, but I prefer maybe before to discuss some positive case where this theory applies. And so so now the question is, now we have really a PDE question. Only a PDE question. We can forget about this, and we can focus really on this problem. So let's say, under which conditions on B the continuity equation is well-posed? Let me say well-posed because, as you have seen, existence is rather easy. So, of course, here I mean the main question is uniqueness in L. Okay, this is the question I would like to discuss. Well, and here comes into play the concept of renormalized solution, already introduced this morning by Lohr, but with slightly different motivations. So anyhow, let me remind the definition of renormalized solutions. So let's take a vector field B. Let's say I will fix a time interval. For technical reasons, I will need also more general time intervals. So let's say an interval, time interval I in R, and the vector field L1 log. So locally integrable. And let's say I take a function also locally bounded. Okay, this way the the product BW is locally integrable, and I have no problem with the weak formulation of the continuity equation. In the sense of distributions, makes perfectly sense, but now I add the renormalization property. I say that W is renormalized okay, and maybe well, there are many ways to introduce this, but maybe the definition becomes more intuitive if we work with the transport formulation. So let me use the transport formulation, okay, where the right-hand side of the equation by assumption is L1 log. Okay, of course, if C is minus WT divergence of B, we have the continuity equation, right? But I think the definition is more intuitive working with the transport formulation. So we say W is renormalized if out of this we can get also, exactly as Lohr wrote, that the derivative of beta W plus beta gradient of beta W is C beta prime of W. Let's say for any beta, C1 in R. Okay? So the name is the same, renormalized, but the motivations are slightly different compared to Boltzmann theory and also compared, for instance, to Vlasov-Poisson. So in these problems, the renormalization is needed basically even to give a meaning to the equation, because even the distributional formulation does not make sense, because there are integrability problems that here we don't have instead. And in some sense, beta is a kind of, as you've seen this morning in connection with Boltzmann equation, is a kind of cutoff function which helps to give a meaning, even to give a meaning to the equation. Here the philosophy is slightly different, because we impose this condition to say that these solutions are in some sense, to be specified, more regular than just distributional solutions. In fact, remark, so first of all, let me say that formally, of course, this implication is true if everything is smooth. You just multiply both sides by beta prime of W, right? And you get out of this, you get this. But this is just a formal implication, because, remark, so under these assumptions, not all distributional solutions are renormalized. And maybe I spend a short time to illustrate a remarkable example found by DePauw. You will find that the precise reference is in my notes. DePauw builds a vector field B, let's say in R2, which is divergence free, is bounded, globally bounded, and also with this property that, let's say, the BV is BV in space, and the BV norm of BT let's say is L1 log. Or let's say maybe 0, 0, 0, 1. Okay, so there is we have BV regularity in space, but we have a blow up of the BV norm as t goes to 0. And for this vector field, it is able to build a solution to the continuity equation, WT, which belongs to minus 1, 1. with the property that Wt weakly converges to zero as t goes to zero. Okay, so yeah, actually no. Okay, so this is actually an this is an example actually of a different phenomenon. Of the fact that okay, I'm sorry. Yeah, maybe this solution is still renormalized. Yeah, I'm sorry. This example is to motivate another phenomenon that. Yeah, actually, in this example, this is just a phenomenon of non-uniqueness. It's not a phenomenon. This solution is simple to check, because if you compute beta W, you just still find only two values. So this solution is still renormalized. It's still renormalized. Yeah, this illustrates actually another phenomenon. It is the phenomenon that we have a problem in general, even with the normalized solutions, with the initial condition, because you see that Wt weakly converges to zero as t goes to zero. But beta Wt, for instance, if you take as beta the modulus, does not converge to beta of zero, because beta of Wt is equal to one as t goes to zero. Right? So in general, even with the normalized solutions, we have problems with the attainment of the initial condition. Right? We might have a loss of continuity, weak continuity, as t goes to zero. Anyhow, this example is important because it shows, of course, that in general, there is no uniqueness. For the continuity equation, it's not an example of the failure or the renormalization property, but it shows that you don't have uniqueness. You start with zero, and the solution is not zero. And actually, basically the idea of the construction is that Wt for t equal 2 to the minus n, let's say for a geometric set of times, is just as just a chessboard structure, right? With the plus one or minus one on a scale which is precisely proportional to the time. Okay, and then intermediate times you slide a little bit this chessboard, passing to a finer chessboard as t decreases. Actually, this example is also important because it shows that there is a direction of time also in these questions. I mean, if we look backward in time, if in this example we look backward in time, in this case there is, so let's say we look from one and we go behind, go to zero, then until zero there is no blow up of the BV norm. And so there is a unique, we will see tomorrow my result about BV vector fields, then there is a unique backward, let's say, flow. And of course, the problems occur in this case in the forward direction. Heuristically, if you trace the trajectories of this vector field until time zero, you will see that there will be a kind of instantaneous branching forward in time at t equals zero. So in this direction, you have flow. And then you have a kind of instantaneous branching at t equals zero. Forward, let's say forward branching. Okay, so this is the DePauw example. Now let's see why this condition is technically useful to prove uniqueness. So the theorem is this. So basically, we can prove under the assumption that all solutions are normalized, we can prove a comparison principle. So let's say that, assume that all solutions, let's say all L-infinity solutions to the continuity equation are renormalized. And assume the usual growth condition that B belongs to L1, B over 1 plus the modulus of X belongs to L1, L1 plus L-infinity. Then the comparison principle holds also again inside my class of actually here also the non-negativity here does not play any role, so holds in let me write L infinity L1 intersection L infinity. Okay? And since the equation is linear, what I have to prove, so in particular, I have uniqueness of solutions, right? So let me give you a quick proof of this fact. Well, first of all, by the linearity of the equation, I need only to show that if W is in L and the W0 is negative, then it remains negative. As I said, there is this technical problem with the strong continuity at time zero. And so to avoid this problem, I will use this trick. I will always extend my continuity equation to negative times. And so let's say I will work in the time interval minus infinity t. Okay, and then of course the solution will be W will be equal to W0 for t negative. And of course, in order to apply this comparison principle, I need to prove that under these conditions, I have the renormalized property in all these intervals. This way I can completely avoid this problem of failure of strong continuity, and I can work with the Grönwall lemma. Okay, so now I choose a renormalization function which is an approximation of the positive part, which is the square root of epsilon squared plus the positive part of z squared minus epsilon. And then I choose a cutoff function phi, identical equal to 1 on the unit ball. And let's say phi, let's say non-negative. And phi identical, phi c infinity with compact support in ball with radius 2. And of course, I will define by phi r the scaled functions r. OK. And then let me write now the renormalization property in the conservative form. In the conservative form, you can write it in this way. It is an equivalent formulation, of course, as soon as you expand the divergence. So the derivative of beta epsilon w plus the divergence of beta epsilon w b is equal to the divergence of B times beta epsilon of W minus W beta epsilon prime of W. Okay. And now, if you compute, so this is the transform of beta, this function beta epsilon, and if you compute it, you will find that, well, first of all, beta epsilon converges monotonically to the positive part. And if you compute this quantity, beta epsilon minus by convexity, this function is negative, and it is between 0 and epsilon, minus epsilon. Okay? And so basically, this quantity is negative and between 0 and minus epsilon. Okay, now I multiply by phi, I integrate. Phi r. And here I find beta epsilon of W B dot W phi r plus the integral of the divergence of B phi r beta epsilon W minus W beta prime epsilon of W. Okay. Here I forgot the usual assumption about the divergence, of course. Here we need that the negative part, for the comparison principle, we need something less. We need that the negative part of the divergence belongs to, we need just a local condition. We need just L1 lock, right? N. Okay, and so now this term here can be bound by epsilon, and again here it plays a role only the negative part of the divergence phi r. And then maybe I will skip the details. Here you can use the growth assumption on the vector field to show that this term goes to zero as r goes to infinity uniformly in epsilon. And so basically what you do, you let first epsilon goes to zero. In this way you kill this term with r fixed. Then you let r go to infinity. In this way you get that the time derivative of the positive part, so this is a classical proof, of course, is negative. And this is true in the sense of distributions in minus infinity t. Okay? In the sense of distribution, but since you know that the wt plus is equal to zero in, let's say, on the negative real line, out of this, you can conclude that Wt is identically zero. For any t, and then this way we prove the comparison principle. Okay? And so now we have seen that we can use the renormalization property to prove comparison and then uniqueness for our continuity equation. And so now the next question is, under which assumptions on the velocity can we prove the renormalization property? Basically, I would like to cover in today's lecture the Sobolev case, and tomorrow I will illustrate the BV case. So let me start from the Sobolev case. The renormalization properties is a completely local property, so I will make only local regularity assumptions on the velocity. So let's say, and at this level also I don't need anything on the divergence, and I will prove this theorem, which is due to DiPerna and Lions. It says that if you have B in L1 lock, W11 lock, and if W, as usual, is L infinity lock, then any distribution of solution is renormalized. And so what we have to do is to try to make rigorous this formal argument of multiplying the equation by beta prime of W. So let me start, maybe I will work only with the continuity equation, right? Okay, let's see. No, okay, I can treat also the general case. So let me start from the transport equation. I fix some renormalization function beta, and the strategy is to try to gain some regularity here by modifying both sides of the equation. So let me call W epsilon W star rho epsilon, W epsilon T, WT star rho epsilon. The convolution will only act on the space variables, so time by time I will do this convolution, and then I will get that D over DT or W epsilon T plus is equal to, let's say, C epsilon. Maybe I will call C epsilon T the analogous epsilon. And then I would like to give to this equation still the structure of a transport equation. But to do this, I have to introduce an error term, which is called the commutator. It's the commutator between the action of the transport and the modification. So let me write in this way, plus bt. So you see that at this level, I don't care to regularize the vector field. I try only to regularize my density. Well, remember, for instance, in the proof of the superposition principle, we were regularizing the flux, the J. And well, here I write it in this way, C epsilon T minus R epsilon T, where R is the commutator, so R epsilon T will be equal to star rho epsilon minus bt. Okay, maybe I will put a star also here to make more clear that this is a commutator. Okay. Okay, and now assume that I know that this commutator, of course this commutator is convergent to zero in the sense of distributions. And this is always true under non-regularity assumptions on B. Assume that I know that R epsilon T converges to zero strongly. In L1 lock. If this happens, then I can make immediately rigorous the formal proof. Why? Because now I multiply this equation by beta prime of W epsilon T, and I get dt, d over dt of beta of W epsilon T plus bt nabla beta W epsilon T. Well, first of all, here there is a small technical point. Under this assumption, you get, since you have regularity in space and you have that this PDE is satisfied, you get that W epsilon T is W1 one lock in time space. And then okay, you can apply the standard chain rule for Sobolev functions. And here you get C epsilon T beta prime of W epsilon minus beta prime of W epsilon T R epsilon T. And then you can pass to the limit. But you see that a priori these functions might be oscillating. I have no control, no strong control on W epsilon T. And so only convergence in the sense of distribution would not be enough to pass the limit. So this is really the crucial ingredient. And it is precisely at this level that the Sobolev regularity or the velocity plays a role. And now to convince you that this is true, we will find an explicit formula for this commutator, another formula for the commutator, which shows why, when you have a Sobolev vector field, you have a strong convergence of the commutator. Okay, let me say that also in this context, cancellations play a big role. And in fact, I forgot to say that to make this computation work, you have to choose an even kernel. And you will see for the proof. So if the kernel is even, we can prove that the convergence is strong. Okay, so let me show you how it works. Well, so let's say explicit formula for the commutator. Okay, from now on, I will forget about the time variable because also the commutator you see acts on any time slice. So imagine for a moment that you have just a Sobolev vector field independent of time. You have a function in L-infinity independent on time. So I will drop the T. And the formula for R epsilon is the integral of W. WY B of Y minus B of X dot nabla or rho epsilon of X minus Y DY, and I will call this term L epsilon. Right, minus W divergence of W of X divergence of B of X. Okay, let us give for a moment this formula for granted, and let me show you why this implies the strong convergence. Well, maybe to see this is better to change variables and to write the L epsilon in this way, right? L epsilon of x changing variables, you can also write in this way as the integral of w of x minus epsilon y b of x minus epsilon y minus b of x over epsilon dot nabla rho of y in dy. And then you see here a typical property of Sobolev function. For a Sobolev function, the difference quotients are strongly convergent. So here y plays the role of the direction where I'm computing the difference quotient. Let's say for any y as functions of x, these difference quotients are strongly convergent to the derivative. And so you get that L epsilon out of this information, then of course you are averaging with respect to all directions with the weight given by nabla rho y. This term, of course, is no problem by the continuity of translations in LP. And so you get out of this formula, you get that L epsilon converges strongly in L1 lock to the integral of to w of x to w the integral of let me check the signs minus w the integral of nabla b of x y dot nabla rho y dy. And then by an integration by parts, well, actually, we already, the point here is to prove strong convergence. We know anyhow that the sum of the limit at this term should be zero, but you see this immediately by an integration by parts. So this plus w divergence of b, of course, is equal to zero because the integral of yi d rho over dyj dy is equal to minus delta ij, right? But again, let me emphasize that the point here is not the computation of the limit, which we know should be zero, but to prove that is the character of the convergence. And here the convergence is strong because the vector field is Sobolev. Let me tell you immediately that this does not work, of course, in the BV case, because in the BV case we know only that this is bounded. And we will see tomorrow how we can go around this difficulty. Right? In general, you can't expect strong convergence when the vector field is BV. Okay, and maybe now I say a few words about the proof of this formula. Yeah, maybe I open also a brief parenthesis about there are other formulas. So there are many ways, in some sense, to exploit these cancellations. And recently, in a work with Dario Trevisan, we found a completely different approach to estimate, to compute the commutator and to estimate the commutator, which is based on the convolution, let's say convolution with the heat semigroup. In this case, one can prove that R epsilon is given by this formula, let's say at least when the divergence of B is equal to zero, is given by the integral between zero and epsilon of P epsilon, let's say the action on the semigroup on a test function. So if you view the commutator as a distribution, the action of the commutator on a test function is the integral of the gradient of the vector field, which is a matrix, times the gradient of PS phi comma the gradient of P epsilon minus S of W ds. And so this is a kind of much more intrinsic formula, which for instance works not only in Euclidean spaces but also manifolds. And one can use this formula, again, when B is Sobolev, to estimate, to prove that the convergence is strong. What plays a role here is a different role of cancellations and, of course, the regularizing properties of the heat semigroup, right? Because W is only an L-infinity function, but it becomes more regular instantaneously, and one can use carefully these estimates to prove strong convergence. Okay. Anyhow, let me go back now to this formula. Okay, so in the proof we should, okay, it's, it is better to introduce now, to prove this formula, it is better to introduce the commutator in the conservative form of the commutator, which I will call R epsilon, which is the divergence of B W epsilon minus, sorry, which is the divergence of BW star rho epsilon minus the divergence of BW epsilon. Okay. And proving this formula is equivalent to show that this formula just computing the extra term which appear expanding the divergence is equivalent to show that R epsilon is equal to L epsilon, well, L is defined there, minus W divergence of B star rho epsilon. Minus W epsilon divergence of B. Okay, so let us prove this formula. So we work with the conservative formulation. So let's take an arbitrary test function phi, and then let us compute the action of R epsilon on this test function. Well, so here, first of all, I integrate by parts, and I write this as the integral of it is convenient to write in this way, WB nabla nabla rho epsilon star phi dy dt. Okay, I will see this as a function of y. Ah, okay, I can also forget about the time variable here because I'm freezing the time variable. And then here I simply leave, expand the divergence, so I get minus the integral of W epsilon, minus the integral of B dot nabla nabla rho epsilon dot W dx minus, and then I have this term here, minus the integral of phi. Here there is also phi, dx. Okay, and minus phi W epsilon divergence of B. Okay, and so you see, I get here immediately this term here, And so what I have to show is that the sum of these two terms corresponds precisely to L epsilon. And to do this, it is sufficient to expand these integrals. So I write this as minus the integral of WY B of Y nabla rho epsilon of Y minus 6 and then the internal integral is with respect to x dy, b of x here. Okay, and here I get minus the integral, and here I get b of x dot nabla the integral. Nabla rho epsilon of x minus y w. Okay, let me check 1 second. So here should be b of y. Sorry, here is b of y, and I was wrong. And right, because and here is also phi of x, dy. And here I get precisely the same term, but with wy and phi of x, dx, dy. And then eventually you use precisely the fact that a gradient of rho is odd to put together these two terms, and you get precisely L epsilon here, okay? Okay, so this shows the result for Sobolev spaces. Very well, so now in the time left, let me just give you the proof of about stability, and then I leave completely to tomorrow the discussion of the case of BV functions, and then maybe tomorrow we'll also say something about the other point of view, the point of view of the quantitative estimates, which provides an alternative technique to the existence, to the uniqueness of the flow. Okay, so let me devote the last part, the last 20 minutes to the discussion of the stability. Which is also a strong motivation for the theory, because in some sense it tells you that this theory is a kind of completion of the standard Cauchy-Lipschitz theory. Okay, so I give a simplified statement. So let me assume, just for simplicity, that the velocities are equibounded to avoid all questions which can be studied of blow up and so on. BH converge to B in L1 lock. And let's say that I'm considering flows, let's say, which are equiregular. With respect to BH. Notice that I'm not assuming any regularity assumption on BH. Although in many applications, of course, BH will be a smooth approximation of B, but I need only that XH are flows associated to BH, which are equiregular. Equiregular means that the constant in the non-compression condition, in the regularity condition, should be uniform with respect to H. So let me say that this means that there exists a constant such that, independent of time and H, for which you have this property. Okay. And then the only regularity assumption I need is for the limit vector field. Let's say that the velocity, the continuity equation with velocity b is well posed, as usual in the class L. Okay, a typical application of this theorem will be, for instance, when you do a smooth approximation of your vector field. For instance, take the Sobolev vector field of the previous theorem, you do a smooth approximation under the bounds on the negative part of the divergence. You know also that the smooth approximation has the same bounds, and so you have for the approximating flows the equiregularity condition, so we are precisely under the assumptions of this theorem. And then the conclusion are, first of all, that there exists a flow regular relative to B. And so, for instance, this can also be used in some situations to prove existence of the flow, but we already proved this under more general assumptions. And second, locally measured. What does it mean? So it's a kind of LP convergence, but it is the natural convergence, as we will see in a moment. This means that the limit as h goes to infinity of, for instance, let's say you integrate on any ball BR, the minimum between 1 and the supremum norm . This limit is equal to 0, right? So basically, it's a convergence in the space of continuous, in the space of continuous functions. Okay. What is the strategy of the proof? The strategy of the proof again goes back to the idea of superposition, Young measures. So the idea first. This is also a strategy, for instance, to prove stability of optimal maps in optimal transportation. What is the idea? The idea is behind this lemma, which says the following. Let's say that you have, as usual, measurable space x. Let's say, I don't want to use x, u and v. And you have a family of maps. You have a positive finite measure in U, and you have a family of maps FH from U to V. And then you have a candidate limit map F from U to V. And then one can prove that FH converges in measure to mu, to F, in measure, and this means exactly as I wrote before, that the limit in h, as h goes to infinity, for instance, another equivalent way to say this is that the measure of the set where the distance in v between FH and F is larger than delta, is equal to zero for any positive delta, right? This is another traditional definition of convergence in measure. If and only if, so we can turn this kind of strong convergence in a kind of weak convergence at the level of Planck's. So this is equivalent to the fact that the kind of transport plans associated to mu are weakly converge And so the strategy of the proof in all these cases, also in optimal transport, is just to associate to this family of maps the plans, taking a weak limit. Then in many situations, like also in optimal transportation, you are able to show that the limit, the weak limit, should have this structure, right? So should still be concentrated on a graph of a function f. And then out of these, you get the strong convergence. Okay, so before proving the lemma, maybe I will prove the lemma later on. Let's see how we can use the lemma to prove stability of flows. So basically, I'm going to prove the lemma with u, let's say, equal to some ball in Rn, and taking as functions v, for instance, the usual space where I put my probability measures. Okay, gamma, let's say, yeah, Rn plus gamma t. And then what I do? Well, first of all, I associate to xh precisely the plans, so eta h, which are the identity cross and here I take as measure mu bar, let's say the Lebesgue measure, the characteristic function of the ball with radius r times Lebesgue measure. If you want, you can normalize it, but this is irrelevant. Bar. And then I take a weak limit. Then I have to check all the assumptions that I need to say that eta is still concentrated on the graph. What are the assumptions? Well, first of all, I need to know, as you remember, I recall this result at the beginning of my lecture, that the continuity equation is well posed. Then I need that the marginals are bounded. But in here, precisely, I need this equiregularity, because the equiregularity at the level of xh, at the level of eta h, becomes that et of eta h is bounded for any time, for any t and any h, by c times Lebesgue measure. And this condition is stable under weak convergence. So passing to the limit, I get that et beta is less than c times Lebesgue measure. And the final condition I need to check is that eta is concentrated on, let's say, pairs x gamma with gamma solution to the ODE. Okay. And maybe, as in the proof of the superposition principle, this is the part which is slightly more delicate. I just give you quickly the idea. The idea is that you start from, you fix a time, t, and you start from this information that the gamma 0 minus 6 minus the integral between 0 and t of bh of s, gamma s, d eta h of x gamma is equal to 0. Okay? And basically what you do is to you pass to the limit in this formula. There is a technical difficulty, as usual, because the limit velocity is not a priori continuous, so one has to make a perturbation argument, but still, of course, the equiregularity and the fact that the BH are strongly convergent in L1 play a role, and eventually, out of this, you get is equal to zero, and since this is true for any time, basically this tells you that eta is concentrated on solutions, okay? And so now I have got a good eta without the concentration property, with this property concentrated on solutions, and so I can use the well-posedness of the PDE to say that eta has precisely a graph structure. So then, eta has a graph structure for some x, so there is no branching. And eventually, this general lemma of measure theory, or if you want, of the theory of young measures, tells me that at the level of maps, going back to the level of maps, xh and x, this means that I have convergence in measure. Okay, and I think I can use the last few minutes to give the proof of this lemma, which is not difficult. So it's a powerful lemma, and the proof is not particularly difficult. Okay, maybe I will. So proof of the lemma. Well, there is the easy implication is that convergence in measure implies convergence of the corresponding measures in the product. Why? Because here, if you want to, you can use this fact that if H converges to F in mu measure, implies that you can find subsequences. So for any sequence, you can extract a subsequence which converges to F mu almost everywhere. So in some sense, informally speaking, convergence in measure is a convergence which metrizes the almost everywhere convergence. And so if you have convergence in measure and you want to pass to the limit in a test function so we would like to pass to the limit in this formula, right? I take a bounded continuous test function in the product and I would like to pass to the limit in this formula. But this is elementary because I can apply the change of variables formula for the push forward. This is the integral of phi of x, f h of x, d mu bar. And this is equal to the integral of phi of x, f of h, d mu bar. And then it's just, if you have already extracted a subsequence in order to get the almost everywhere convergence, this is just dominated convergence and the continuity of the test function. So let me give you the maybe less intuitive and less trivial implication. So let me assume that I have this convergence. And I want to prove convergence in measure. Okay, I fix delta. As usual, there is the difficulty that a priori f is not continuous. So let me find, by losing theorem, a function f tilde continuous. Where the difference between f and f tilde is small. Let's say it's less than epsilon. And then I define, I want to test this convergence on a particular test function, the distance between y, the minimum between y, between 1, and the distance in v between y and f tilde of x over delta. Okay? So this is a bounded continuous test function. And so I know, in particular, I know that the Lim sup, I apply immediately the change of variables formula of the mean is less than the same quantity computed for the limit measure. And then I can use the fact that these two f and f, you see this function is 0 when y is equal to f tilde. And the set where f is different from f tilde is small, so you get that this is less than epsilon. OK, and so I need only here to bound this from below. I need only to bound this from below. And here is 1 over delta. And this is, okay, let me check. This is larger than minus epsilon. Again, there is an error I make when I replace f by f tilde minus plus the Lim sup of h of the minimum. One over delta, the distance. Okay. And then playing with this parameter, first you let epsilon go to 0, and then in this way you can playing also with, well, actually delta maybe is not even needed in this proof, because this way you prove you can let also delta equal to 1. Letting epsilon go to 0, you prove that the limit of the minimum between 1 and the distance is equal to 0, which means that there is convergence in measure. Okay? And so this proves the lemma. And I think a good time to stop also for the picture.